gospel time coming to you from the Church of God, located at 4601 South Drexel Boulevard, Chicago, Illinois, where the pastor's Elder Ricky is. Jackson, and True Joy, directed by Brother Kenneth Boyd.
Thank you. but I thank God I have true joy. And joy because I'm delivered from sin. Joy because I'm delivered from the drinking. Joy because I'm delivered from the drugs. I appreciate God for true joy. True joy in my soul because Jesus, amen, resides within. Amen. Thank God for gospel time. And this is gospel time. Amen. And those in radio land, I'm sorry. And social media, we appreciate you being with us. Appreciate you tuning in with us. Our duty is to preach this gospel. Amen. Our duty is to see people delivered from a life of sin. That's what we want to see. Amen. I know this world is going in another direction. Amen. But there is one direction that we're going. Amen. And we're focused on it. Amen. Our minds, our eyes are set on it. Amen. And that is that we are heaven bound.
Yes, sir.
Amen. And we made a determination. Amen. That we're not going to go the way of the world. Amen. But we're going to go the way that God
wants. Yes,
at this time, let us bow our heads and look to the Lord in prayer.
Amen.
Our Father, we thank you, Lord, for all that you've done for us. Truly, Lord God, we are thankful in our souls, thankful in our hearts, dear God. My God, thank you for the true joy, dear God, that we have. Thank you, dear God. My God, Lord, that as we face the enemy time and again, dear God, Father, we realize sometimes we have to sing them off of us, dear God. My God, Lord, we can't just let the enemy, Lord, take us into the valley, take us into the doldrums, Lord. But God, as the song says, sing my soul and all within me. Sing till all the clouds remove. Sing and shout. I am praying forever that our Lord, our God, is love. My God, Lord, that's what keeps us singing. That's what keeps us going, dear God, to know the love of God. My God, that has delivered us from the clutches of sin. Today, dear God, we ask, my God, that your anointing would be upon the speaker. Use him for your glory, dear God. Truly, Lord God, he needs you. Father God, Lord, as he stands between time and eternity, my God, help him to preach the word of God. Be instant in season, out of season, reprove, rebuke, exhort with all long suffering and doctrine. My God, Lord, speak to the hearts of men. My God, those that are listening. My God, on social media, those in this audience that don't know you, God. Father, we pray, God, that you would break down, my God, Lord, walls, Lord God. My God, Lord, soften stony hearts, dear God. Might your word pierce, might your word search, might your word, my God, heal, we ask in the name of Jesus. Bless and have your way. And truly we give you praise in Jesus' name. Amen. Amen. Amen.
Amen.
Amen. Before the speaker comes, you may say it's unusual to see all the ministers are sitting in the pulpit on a Sunday morning. Amen. But I want to read a scripture here in 1 Samuel 17 chapter, please. 1 Samuel 17 chapter. Amen. For those that may be our guests today, our visitors, and those in social media, we, as a congregation, have determined, amen, to go on a 90-day challenge.
Amen.
Amen. Amen. And
yes,
we have made a determination that we're going to turn the battle to the gates.
Amen.
I'm tired of seeing the devil bully. I'm tired of God's people around. I'm tired of seeing that. You know, most of the time, the only time you can get a bully off you you gotta show them I ain't scared of you. I'm not afraid of you.
My God.
I'll say it for social media sake. Amen. And for visitors of the congregation knows, when I was younger, I encountered this a young man at school when I was in grammar school. His name is Michael Taylor. I don't know, he may be listening right now. I ain't looking for no fight now, Michael. I mean, he would bully me, he would push me around. I mean, any on the run. He just, one day.
Sure.
I remember waking up that morning.
All right.
I said enough is enough. Enough is enough. I remember being in the hall, and I guess he wanted to show everybody. We were in between classes, you know, the stairway and everything was full of students and everything. And he wanted to show what he was going to do to Dukes again.
All right, boy.
But he didn't know where I was at that point.
Right.
So, you know, he went to acting up and, you know, pushing on me and all that, and I pushed him back.
Right.
He was like, what, really? And he started taking his sweater off and all that. At that point, I was like, there you go, man. Lord will anoint our brother. Let's receive Brother Jensen Rosenberg with a hearty amen.
Amen.
Amen. Amen. Amen. Come on.
As always, thank you, Pastor Dukes. Appreciate God for my pastor.
Amen.
True man of God. I believe him and every minister up here and everybody that in this congregation that's here, that's truly a member of this local body, is saved.
Amen. Amen.
I believe that.
Amen.
Amen. I thank God. That's saying a lot in these last days. A ministry and a congregation free from sin. How about that? When you talk about consecration and fasting and all that, I don't believe anybody here wants us during this time to just be another group with a cause on a hunger strike.
Right.
We want to reach God. Amen. We want to see fruit for our sacrifice. I'm already believing that God is working.
Yes.
But I'm not giving up by the grace of God.
Amen.
Amen. As well as most of us is, our main burden here is salvation of souls.
Yes, sir.
As souls through Jesus Christ will be delivered from the bondage of sin.
That's right, sir.
And after that, that they will be nourished and blessed and strengthened in this local body.
Amen.
Amen. Through the ministry, the teaching, the services we have here.
Right. Amen.
That's why it's so important to forsake not the assembly together.
Amen.
Of ourselves, as the matter of some is. We want to talk from, well, first scripture would be Acts 26 chapter. We do have a burden. And there for quite a while, I told Pastor Dukes a while back, I said, the line may be around the block. He says, put me in the line. I have a burden.
All right, my brother.
Amen.
Bless the Lord.
Respect every minister here.
Amen.
The word of God that comes from their mouths.
Amen.
The grace of God. Acts 26 and verse number 16 and 17, please. Sit down. Thank you very much.
Amen.
But rise and stand upon thy feet, for I have appeared unto thee for this purpose.
For this purpose.
To make thee a minister and a witness both of these things which thou hast seen, and of these things in the which I will appear unto thee.
That's not just for the ministry. It's the word of God. It's for every one of us. Stand on your feet. Rise up. We don't know for such a time as this will be the most crucial time in the history of the world. Amen. I believe it may very well be. Amen. And for such a time in your life, though you may think it unimportant or insignificant or not famous or anything like that, this could be the most important time in your life. To really be somebody in the Lord. To really make a difference in people's lives. Amen. And for those that are not saved, if God is dealing with your heart to be sorry for your sins, to give up your sin, and to trust in Jesus Christ, who's the only one who can save you, to make your life, to make your heart right.
Yes, sir.
This is your time.
Yes, sir.
You may have to do it now. You may never have another opportunity. But there's something that stands in all of our way. If we're not delivered from this, and it's closely linked with sin, if we're not delivered from this, we don't have a chance. It's something our former pastor used to talk about a lot. Next verse, please.
Delivering thee from the people.
Delivering thee from the people.
And from the Gentiles.
And from the Gentiles.
Unto whom now I send thee.
The ungodly. Unto whom now I send thee. We got to live in a world full of, as saved people, so-called Gentiles. You could say this was the type back then of this ungodliness and ungodly people and ungodly influences through people today. And there are many of them. Our title was a people, oh, you Periscope people, a people delivered from people.
Okay.
To some degree, I cannot get saved, you cannot get saved without being willing to be delivered from people. I found working many, many years at the jail, laboring here for many years, dealing with souls, that this problem, that problem, in most cases, not the majority of all cases, the biggest problem is not just giving up the things they're bound by, even the things they enjoy that are sinful, but looking away from the influence of people. How many people have we dealt with here? How many people have come in and out of these doors here? Would still be here if they had just given up the influence of people on their life. Now, we're not fools here. We're not some strange gospel here. We're bound, in a sense, by people. We're no closer to Jesus Christ than we are to one another and how we treat human beings. That's how close we are to Christ. We get that. Amen. I can't be a help to Pastor Dukes or Elder Hall or any of you all in a certain degree unless I'm delivered from thee. You know why? Because people mess up. Even saved people get on the wrong track sometimes. How much division do we have in the body because saints of God didn't consider that they were bound by people and other people's influence? It was ridiculous things to divide the body. That's not even a message per se. Ridiculous things. Vision is still sin, folks. Sorry. I don't see you right because of something that is not delineated in the Bible. I'm in trouble with God. But so many people struggle even to get saved and just can't get their eyes, their mind off this copycat business. What's this person going to think about? What are they going to say about it? What are they doing? I can't get saved. Oh, you won't party with them anymore. Huh? My mother won't see me right anymore. My dad won't see me right anymore. If I come home and I'm standing against person and libel, or you holier than thou, person and lying and womanizing. As long as you're involved with that mess, a lot of our relatives and people, as long as you're involved with that mess, you're just fine and down to earth for them. That's their joy, that's their peace in life. It's a few moments of thrill. They don't have joy or peace. A few moments of thrills and pleasure. It's not so much that I'm hooked up on that stuff. I'm willing, baby, to give that stuff up so I can find joy and peace in the Lord. But I'm not willing to stand against people. I'm afraid. But maybe it's not that. It, I was afraid. I'm so enamored by it. My connection with other people. Because so many young people today, so many young people that have passed through our doors, our children, things like that, they get hooked up with friends, with ungodly influences. It may not be big time sin. I don't want to disappoint the crowd. I don't want to lose my friends. But let me tell you something, it's better you have Jesus, the friend, than a whole bunch of mediocre friends. You know why? You know why? Because they got no power to give you, no grace, no joy, no peace, no hate. People are supposed to be a people delivered from thee. Amen. People do it. He said, delivering thee from the people and from the Gentiles, unto whom now I send thee. And we've all been sent on our jobs. In the community, and we're with ungodly influences all the time. People that are not saved. People, well known, that still use profanity, right? People that still may elbow you there. Brother Barber said, look at that skirt. Look at that. We're not going to look. Huh?
Right.
People that still want you to drink with them. people that still want you to gang up with them to hate somebody.
All right.
I'm a white guy, okay? I can't help it. Whites that want me to team up with them to hate black folks. Blacks that want you to team up with them to hate white folks. None of that's of God. Who was standing? They ever said, who was standing with me against the workers of iniquity? Who's actually going to get saved in the first place? Psalms 1 and 1. People delivered from people. You know what? When anybody gets saved, God give them enough grace. If they really consider it, and they hold their salvation, they keep obeying God in a little thing, they'll keep that grace in their soul that at any given time, they can stand for the word as opposed to people. I don't care who it is, whether they're professing to be saved or not. How much more getting saved? I would get saved but for so and so. I will get saved but for. It all lines up for the band, but I can't get saved because of my connection to so and so. Times 1, times 12, whatever. Amen. Psalms 1.
Blessed is the man,
yes, ma'am,
that walketh not in the counsel of the ungodly, nor standeth in the way of sinners,
yes,
nor sitteth in the seat of the scornful.
Yes.
But his delight is in the law of the Lord.
We'll stay right there. Blessed is the man. You could flip the coin, as you could do with many scriptures, and say, cursed is the man that does walk in the counsel of the ungodly, that does stand in the way of sinners, that does sit in the seat of the scornful. If I'm doing any of that stuff, how can I be saved? Putting their influence above total surrender to God.
Yeah.
And the maintenance, yes, thereof.
Yes.
Psalm 101 was still there. Blessed is the man that walketh not in the counsel of the ungodly,
yes,
nor standeth in the way of sinners. Amen. Nor sitteth in the seat of the scornful. There's a lot of counsel out here now.
Yes, sir.
You know? A lot of counsel, and it's a lot of it seems very important. No? We all are in agreement that, you know, if it'll help you get a good career, if it'll help you in the math, sciences, and all that, in those who are able, not everybody, go to college, get a college degree.
Sure.
Amen. And a lot of these professors, and I come from, I'm a black sheep in the family. I don't want to, we didn't go to college and get a PhD, not just a bachelor. My brother Eric, teachers out east, my late dad, he was here at Circle Campus here, U of I.
Amen.
They all, and my dad came from a very poor background, Italian and Jews there in Brooklyn, New York. They went, and my family, for the most part, they very much encouraged getting college education. I tried, I tried a couple times. But and I'm not knocking it at all. When we go to these institutions, saved or unsaved, there's a lot of ungodly stuff going on. By people that are held in reference just because of their title.
Yes.
I'm big prof, monkey muck, whatever my name is. PhD. Whatever else you want to tack on the end of my name. That's all well and good. Amen? But if I'm teaching things that are totally contrary to the Word of God, you pay me tax money and a tuition on top of that. Send your child to these places. We need to be aware of the counsel of the ungodly. Most public institutions now, you can't go in there and you got a professor that's teaching totally pro-homosexuality. As if it was the gift of God or something like that. You stand up against that, you're in trouble. I'm sorry to say, some people, no doubt, have gone in there saved, got affected by that stuff and dropped their guards, and they got barraged by that from so many different sides, whether it be homosexuality, transgenderism, you name it. All kind of stuff.
Yes, sir.
Amen. And the federal government, most part, supports that. There are a few universities where they won't teach that stuff. Few. Amen. And majority of those you may find are funded otherwise.
Sure.
So they can do that and not say, hey, have to be, otherwise the government could almost pretty much shut them down. Fund-wise. Amen. So it's so popular. Counsel with Young God. Radio, television, universities. Even elementary schools. Reading somewhere recently where they are introducing, you know, children's books now, right and left. Promoting a man and wife. But Jeff, this is just a betrayal, right? Walking down the street with suit and tie. Amen. But he's my wife. Oh, God is right. Amen. Promote that stuff in elementary school. We are turning those of us who don't have the money, whatever, to put a child in a locale or don't feel impressed by God to homeschool them, they're going to public school. We got to put something else in there. It's night and day to counteract that garbage. Walking in the counsel of the ungodly. And who will stand, though? Standing in the way of sinners. I can't get saved. Because that's my people. But Brown, I'll disappoint my people. I'll disappoint my sinner buddies. Or my Italian family, my black family, or the this, the other mess, they're people. They're going to either the same heaven or hell that you're going to. We can be a blessing one to another, but we can never be God one to another. And you've got God living in you, and I got God living in me, Brother Mario, man. It's a wonderful thing. And I know you love me because if I get out of line, you're going to try to help me get back in line. And vice versa. You've got people that can't even get saved. Get the influence of people. And it's a blinding thing. It's a blinding thing. Can't get loose with it by talking about it. Here he is. If I'm shacking up, thank God my wife's over there. Don't give me a funny idea. Sorry. Here it is. If I'm a sinner and I'm shacking up with somebody, and we really love one another, but it's a sinful thing. Not only is it just going to add a wedlock, we're involved with stuff, you know, just that we know our life, we're not saved. But I can't get saved because of the influence of that other. I know. God has revealed to me. You want me, peace and joy, and you start on the road to a prosperous life in me, in many ways, or you want him. You want your buddy of 30 years? God will deal with people this way, folks. You want to be a people delivered from people. Thank God for the people of God. I'm closer to the people of God than I am my own natural family. Amen. Thank God for that. Amen. But ultimately, to be happy in life and to have power to live right, I need God in my soul 24/7. And I need to maintain that relationship with him. You can't do that for me, Elder Jeff. You can't do that for me, Brother Corey. Who's willing to get seen and look away from people? Who's willing to stay safe? Amen. And stand when the situation comes up against people? Well, you know, I've been saved for 30 years for Jeff, and you know, I've been hanging out and clicking with brother so-and-so and sister so-and-so. Our families are tight and their families are tight. And if brother so-and-so loses out with God and he stops having devotion and get bitterness of heart against Pastor Deuce,
right,
and basically renounces Pastor Deuce, and then starts a congregation in Blackfoot, Idaho, I'm going with brother so-and-so.
Right.
There is a Blackfoot, Idaho, by the way. Look it up. I'm going with him. How many times have you seen that happen? What's the good? Is there a good reason for that happening? Brother so-and-so did not die for your sins. People delivered from people. Can't be anything in life unless we're delivered from
them.
Nothing in life unless we are delivered from people. Can we finish Psalms 1? How about 2, verse 2, please?
But his delight is in the law of the Lord,
yes,
and in his law does he meditate day and night.
His delight is in the law of the Lord, and in his law doth he meditate in it. Isn't that wonderful?
Yes.
You got that joy, that like, that shade, that presence in my every day. The word is first in my life. What I've learned, whether it be from the ministry director or my own devotion, whatever, that word is just keeping me through the living God. Keep me company every day. Keep me living right. Quickening me not to do this or that. People can't do that, folks. We don't put the word about people in bad shape. People delivered. Delivered from people. Of Luke 16 and 15, please. One of my favorite scriptures. Bye-bye.
And he said unto them, ye are they which justify yourselves before men.
I said Luke 16 and 15, correct?
Yes.
Can you give me 14, 15, and 16? Same.
And the Pharisees also, who were covetous, heard all these things, and they derided him.
Derided him. They made fun of him. They mocked him.
Right.
They teased him. What else?
And he said unto them, ye are they which justify yourselves before men.
You, your whole life, is what people think of you.
Wow.
Even though Jesus said one time, he made himself of how much reputation? Zilch. He didn't base his life on his effectiveness, on who he was, or his standing with God the Father, on what people thought of him. Going with the crowd.
Yes.
We're about to find out that most cases, if not all cases, going with the crowd is usually wrong.
Yes.
In a worldly sense.
Yes.
In a worldly sense, going with the crowd is wrong. It's not a copycat salvation, folks.
No.
Can't be. Amen. What do you say? Verse 15.
And he said unto them, ye are they which justify yourselves before men.
Justify yourselves before men.
Yeah.
What?
But God knoweth your hearts.
God knows your heart that you are not right with God. You're religious, but you're not right. That's what's going on right now as we speak. All over the world, especially in this country. People getting together to justify themselves before men. Church goers, no, they're still cussing. No, they're still lying. No, they still hate this race or this. No, they still cheat on their wife. No, they still get drunk. No, they still shoot it up. No, they got two or three women on the side. Amen. No, they're looking at stuff they shouldn't be looking at. No, these things. Don't have any control. They're not saved. They justify themselves because they punch the clock, so to speak, and let a preacher preach to them every Sunday. Who's basically preaching them a message. Have a mental belief in the Lord Jesus Christ and stay the same condition you are. God understands. Don't be delivered from the disease and power. Sam. Don't. Just don't. Oh, they would never say that, Brother Jason. In their lives, many cases of doctrine. That's exactly what they say. You are those who justify yourself in these groups and whoever you're hanging with. Whoever has influence in your life. That's the justification of having some worth in life. Jesus said it's worthless. What?
But God knoweth your hearts.
God knows your heart.
For that which is highly esteemed among men.
That which is highly respected, highly popular, highly glorified, highly publicized among men.
It's an abomination in the sight of God.
God doesn't like it. Don't do that. I'm like, no, he says it's an abomination. What's abomination mean? That which is greatly hated or detested. Not hated anything. Greatly hated. And God put his name on this. Sign God. If it's highly esteemed among men, more than likely, it's an abomination. Holy abomination. People delivered from people. Who is delivered from this? Very few people. Very, very, very few. A lot of the ones I know that are delivered from people, they're, thank the Lord, they're in this room right now. I believe that. I believe it. Well, how about me? How about you? Am I delivered from people? Am I afraid to stand for what's right? Because it's not popular? Huh? Because my co-workers won't like me? Because my family members, my blood family members will detest me? Because this is one thing that we have exonerated and gone through all our lives. And we glorified this or that, or this celebrity, or this kind of music, or whatever. And now, God has delivered me from these things.
Amen.
Will the world pull me back? Will I not even get saved? Because I'm not willing to tune out and stand against that which is popular. Something about popularity and the media and all this thing, it controls a lot of people's lives. It controls their lives. They cannot see His truth. They cannot see God. The scripture said, blessed are the pure in heart. They're the only ones that see God. They see Him in this situation, that situation. They see Him all day long. Sometimes we don't realize it. Maybe at times He may make the way a little darker so that we have to seek after Him more. We're not maybe seeking after Him like we should.
Right.
For direction, guidance, unction, influence,
yes.
All that.
Yes.
But that which is highly esteemed.
Yes.
Is that what it said? That verse 16, sister?
That's the middle of verse 15. For that which is highly esteemed among men.
Yes.
Is abomination in the sight of God.
Abomination. Verse 16, please.
The law and the prophets were until John.
All right.
Yes.
Since that time, the kingdom of God is preached, and every man presseth into it.
Amen. Every man presseth into it. 1 Corinthians 15, 33. Got to press into it. That's why we have this time of consecration now. Because we just let things go. The press that we need, even just to stay saved, that can take a long
yeah.
Diminishment.
Yeah.
Awake to righteousness.
Awake to righteousness.
And sin not.
Stop sinning forever. And who's willing today? That's not saved. Here. Periscope land. Who is willing to awake to righteousness?
Yes, sir,
and stop sinning? Paul, back in his day, said, some have not the knowledge of God. What does it say, sister?
Awake to righteousness and sin not, for some have not the knowledge of God.
Yeah, knowledge.
I speak this to your shame.
I speak this to your shame. Nowadays, you could easily insert, many have not the knowledge. Because he only really had basically one body while Paul was alive that had enough courage, backbone to call themselves the church.
Yeah, yeah.
We are called out. That's what church means.
Right.
From sin.
Yes.
Willful sin. Inbred sin.
Right.
False religion. We're called out from all that stuff.
Yeah.
By the grace of God.
Yeah.
But now, that stuff is the most popular. We're a speck on the landscape population-wise as far as the population of this local congregation and the various ones that believe this truth. The United States. A speck on the landscape compared to the overall amount of places that call themselves by that same name, church. And if I'm not saved, I got to figure out. I got to listen to God say, what's the real church?
Yes.
And what's not?
Because
you got a lot more out here calling itself church.
Yes.
What's the difference? Go to the church of your choice. I sin, you sin, we all sin. We're all sinners saved by grace.
Yes.
Praise the Lord. Lord, have mercy.
Lord, have mercy.
Praise God. Every night, Brother Jason, you ever hear a minister talk to me? And Brother Jason, every night when I go to bed, I ask God to forgive me for willful, intentional sin. Because I know nobody can be free from sin. All that mess, we could spend here till probably 3 in the morning giving you scriptures, Old Testament, New, say all that mess is wrong.
Right.
That which is highly esteemed among men is an abomination to God.
Yeah.
But Jason, you offended me. That is my pest. You talk about my quiet. You saying just because they cuss and sleep together that they're not saved?
Yeah.
Huh? I've been going to that place for 32 years.
Yes,
they're more saved than you are. They're more religious than you are. The latter I might give you. You employ a lot of energy, Brother Corey, to being religious and not have a speck of God in our soul. So cussing and lying and cheating and fornicating, all kind of stuff. That's not God's people. That's just a generic name, church. Basically, all they've been called out of is off the street for 90 minutes into a building. That's what they've been called out of. God never talked about being saved in sin, Brother Martin. Never. All the scriptures he talked about that is always saved from sin. Brother Wiley, to go and sin how much?
No more. Right.
I heard that. You said no more. Same difference. No more. No more. Go and sin no more. Who said go and sin no more?
Jesus.
Who? What did Jesus mean? I figured he knew what he was talking about. What did Jesus mean? The word. It's just a word, really, that was turned into a name. It means Savior. Look it up. Old Testament New. Same name as Joshua in the Old Testament. It means bluntly Savior. You figure he knows what he's talking about. For some name Savior. Now, ain't nobody can save me from my sins. I want to keep going to church, hanging out with my family. I leave the church. Today's the big football game. We're going to go to the tavern. Amen. We're going to get drunk. We're going to watch Tom Brady sling the rock. Amen. And we're going to hope some nice females are there too. Amen. Not God's church. Amen. Not God's church at all. Thank the Lord. Will I stand up for God? Will I make a move to get saved? Knowing that I still have the disease of sin in my life, but what's binding me and gluing my feet to the floor, amen, is people. People. How many have been lost because they put people first? Amen. Will I get help from God if I am saved? The devil has been talking some mess in my mind against Elder Hall.
Amen.
Elder Deborah Adams.
Yes,
Elder Jeff Buford.
Yes,
and I know it's choking the life of God out of me. These are our individuals, pastor, that God has ordained to give me the word of God.
Yes.
And I'm just going to think about coming to church and think about all this stuff. I mean, just can't wait to get out of here.
God.
I'm still saved. I'm still a member of this congregation. I don't see them right. Why? Because my friends from somewhere else that I grew up with, my bosom buddies for 30, 40 years, whatever, have been dropping little drops of poison in my ears against these individuals. It's from Mike Zimmons saying he's not safe. Amen. Well, I got to be happy, so I got to go with the people I'm comfortable. Why are you comfortable with sin? Why is there enough God in your soul that you can't see the scriptures that prove all things Amen. You should want to have your soul fed. You should want to be happy in the Lord.
Amen.
Vision. Sin. All this stuff because of people. You can be delivered from you. Amen. What did I call? What did I call? Oh, yeah, we're still there. 1 Corinthians 15. What did I say?
Verse 34.
34, please, yeah.
Awake to righteousness.
Yes.
And sin not.
I made a mistake. Forgive me. 33.
Verse 33, be not deceived.
Be not deceived. Many are deceived. What?
Evil communications corrupt.
Evil associations. Communication. Bonding. Evil communications is what?
Corrupt good manners.
Corrupt good behavior. Ability to live right and act right. That power supply is cut off by evil communication. Associations. Bonding.
Yeah.
Amen.
Amen.
Cut off.
Amen.
God comes out. I got a nice pipeline of golden oil to feed your soul. The word of the Spirit.
Yeah.
Keep you happy and powerful living right in the Lord. Take that and twist it up.
My God.
No more oil for you. Because you put people above me. Because you refuse to be delivered from people. And you've made human influence your God. That's why he came. That's why he came. That's why he came spacing. That's why we end up in some place, out of the way place, where the word of the Spirit is no longer taught. Amen. Because of people above God. Amen. That word, that Spirit is a wonderful thing. Word and Spirit. And God will think enough of us. These cellular in people that are going back to the dust to live and move and walk around with us. Keep us safe all day long and keep us happy in the Lord. Are you happy in the Lord?
Yes.
Amen. Anyway. Let me say that consecration, it shouldn't make you unhappy. It shouldn't make you bitter towards people, impatient towards people. I'm fasting, they don't talk to me here.
My God.
I had a taste, brother, you prefer a triple cheeseburger. Shouldn't take our joy or peace at all. God's got grace. He's calling you to do something and you agree to it. Amen. He got grace to be after the Lord. In spite of the suffering. That's the way God does things. You know what? He really does. Even when we lose loved ones or tragedies happen in our lives. Amen. How many has that ever happened to you? Oh man, you lost a loved one. Or some great disappointment in your life. Not allowed it to happen. Did it take your joy? Did it take your happiness? Did it take your peace? You look back and say, that was something good I had to go through. But it didn't take any of that. Amen. People deliver. You've got to be delivered from people. What does it say, Sister Allison?
Verse 33, be not deceived.
Yeah.
Evil communication corrupt good manners.
Great deception. Evil communication corrupt good manners. What?
Awake to righteousness.
Awake to righteousness.
And sin not.
Stop the sin business.
For some have not the knowledge of God.
They don't have the knowledge of God. You've got to be delivered from people.
I speak this to your shame.
I speak this to your shame. Amen. Yeah, I think we can go to one more scripture. Let's see here. Which one to pick? We got that. Which one to pick from? It's the best. Let's go to Hebrews 2 and 2.
All right.
Let's see. Who's our perfect example? Christ. Not little Jason. I can get wrong. I can go off on a tangent. I can listen to the wrong voice. By the grace of God, you pray for me that I don't.
Yes, sir.
I pray for you. Well, ultimately, our safeguard is that Jesus. Not like these stupid lanyards that people put around. I'll say stupid, forgive me. But these lanyards, well, that's all they got all day. What would Jesus do? What would Jesus do? They're looking at this thing and they're cursing in between. What would Jesus do? You know why they do it? Because they got no power. never been changed. We don't teach that here. I thank God. And I thank Him continuously for the doctrine we get here at 4601 South Direction Boulevard. Ultimately, it definitely does not come from here. Because we tore down this building, you'd have piles of dirt underneath here. It's not coming from there. It comes from heaven. And the only way it's been perpetuated in our services, our Friday night Bible class, whatever, the only way it has been perpetuated is through vessels that have continued to obey God and not be bound by evil.
Wow.
Coming all the way down past groups, this group here, and this group here.
Right.
Amen.
Hebrews chapter 2, verse 2.
Verse 2, please.
For if the word spoken by angels was steadfast.
If the word spoken by angels was steadfast.
And every transgression and disobedience received a just recompense of reward.
God had no mercy, Elder Brown, all he had was judgment. That's what we're trying to tell you. What?
How shall we escape?
How shall we escape?
If we neglect so great salvation.
Yes.
Which at the first began to be spoken by the Lord.
Yes.
And was confirmed unto us by them that heard him.
That's Hebrews 2 and 2?
Yes, it is.
Amen. I think maybe I meant 12 and 2.
All
right. You see the gray hair, right? That was definitely good. Thank you.
Hebrews chapter 12, verse 2.
Yes.
Looking unto Jesus.
Looking unto Jesus. Looking unto Brother Marvin. Looking unto Sister Alice. Looking to my friend, Brother Marco. No.
Looking unto Jesus.
Looking unto Jesus.
The author and finisher of
the creator and the accomplisher of our faith. What?
Who for the joy that was set before him.
Who for the joy? What's the joy that was set before him? Pastor Dukes brought it out years ago. Well, he connected the two. Paul said, what is my hope or joy or crown of rejoicing? If you can sing, the same saved. He brought that out in a message. It's called Give Me Children, must I die? 1989. I have to dig that one out, maybe, but I don't know if I have a cassette player that works in this. Yes.
Who for the joy that was set before him?
Who for the joy that was set before him?
Endured the cross.
Endured the cross.
Despising the shame.
And what's the shame?
And it set
down. I can't
do
anything. Some people are so timid. They're so fearful. Need to get the victory over fear. God, Bible said God had not given his people a spirit of fear, but of power and love and a sound. Look it up in the Greek, a strong mind. Some people have a weak mind. God don't want you to stay that way forever. Yeah. Yeah. Oh, a strong mind, and I don't care who you are, on everybody's level. Everybody in this room, I'm not talking about a genetic or a biological problem. Everybody in this room, we stay saved, your minds should be getting stronger.
Yeah.
Mental
capacity.
I'm not talking about forgiveness, that's biological. I'm talking about spiritual, mental, and the spiritual.
Yeah.
What do you say again?
Looking unto Jesus.
Looking unto Jesus.
The author and finisher of our faith.
Author and finisher of faith.
Who for the joy that was set to before
joy,
him.
Joy, what's your joy today? Huh?
Yes, sir.
I draw a paycheck every week?
Amen.
What's your joy? That I meet once a year for Thanksgiving with the children and relatives to get drunk? What's your joy? Huh? What's your joy? People, those things may bring pleasure for a while. Not joy. Condemnation, the darkness, the loneliness, the misery comes back. Or even worse. Who for the joy that was set before him, you and me being saved.
Endured the cross.
Endured great suffering. The cross. Great shame. There was nothing more ashamed, shameful. Even if you were innocent, Brother Tony. If you were innocent. And you had a corrupt government, and they hung you up on a cross. There was nothing more shameful.
Yeah.
Even if you didn't deserve a bit of that shame.
Right. Yeah. Oh, yeah.
And this is not the only age of corrupt government, folks.
Right.
been going on since Jesus was around, at least before that. Read your Bible. Who for the joy that was set before him, what?
Endured the cross.
Endured the cross.
Despising the shame.
He didn't just ignore it in that button. Despised it. Its influence on his life. It's not affecting me at all. People try to shame you out, Pastor, as doing the will of God. Because it's not popular. Because people are not going to get along with you. Certain people are doing the will of God. If he wants to stay saved, he has to despise the shame. And be pure. On your job sometimes, you got to despise the shame. You've got to join in with this activity or that activity. Or we're going to make it tough for you to work on a job. You might even not be working on your job. Well, I guess God has another job for me. It's ultimately not up to me to feed my family, up to God. Since I desire in this case, sir, to put God above me. Amen. What does it say?
And is set down at the right hand of the throne of God.
Set down at the right hand of the throne of God. Amen. He despised the shame. How about that? Isn't that wonderful? Like I said before, I know that Philippians said, he made himself a already. He's been teaching us for years. Well, I don't know, he likes to teach on the same scripture. How Jesus, amen, thought it not robbery. Pardon the expression. To hang with God and the angels in heaven. Not robbery. A robbery means a prize to be held and not let go of. A prize. Turn the verse. Well, I don't think he said.
That's good, brother.
That's what we can do. 1976, right? You need to be saved. He said, he's holding on to heaven. Nothing but joy, peace, comfort. No 10 below zero winters in Chicago. None of that. He said, whoop. You're right.
Amen.
Down
to the filth. Down to the cussers. The liars. The connivers. The debauched sexual individuals, perverts. You know what he said? I want to save
them
all. And you know what? It's just as important to him. Everybody that is saved, he said this in the scripture to Paul, I want to come to this truth.
Yes, sir.
Well, I would agree with everything he said, but Jason, but I would be a great disappointment. They're calling me to the ministry over on up in Evanston or Skokie or 95th Street, wherever. How could I just disappoint them? They just made me quiet.
Okay.
God said, if I could do this and make myself a zero reputation. Matter of fact, I even subjected myself to more shame than you'll ever even have to come close. Someone spit in your face is nothing compared to the cross. Aren't you being willing to be delivered for people? Whatever your problem is, aren't you? If people have anything to do with it, what you're facing, even saved or unsaved, aren't you willing to put God first in your life? We're not asking you to come and bow to us. We're nothing. The ministry here is saying, we're nothing without God. Nothing. This whole thing is building people, singing in the choir and everything. It's nothing without God. It's a big joke without God. It's a disgrace without God. But when we got God, we got power to live free. We got power to do, when we first get saved, we got power to do nothing but grow in grace. And now we're in a totally different program than the world. The world's out for good time. That's pretty much it, right? We talk about a TV show. They're out for good time. We have greater joy and peace than they could ever approach to in the world. But we're not going to have a program of just good times. Amen. Cheap thrill. We want souls to be saved. Through my life. Your life. I want souls to be saved. To help anyway. We want souls here. People that come here. We just don't want you to come here. You pay tithes. And just support the congregation that way and be a bump on the lot. Who wants you to flourish in the Lord? That's the ministry's job. people, delivered from people. And much more we could share, but turn over to Pastor Dukes. Please pray for me. I just want to stay saved. I want to stay delivered from sin and delivered from people.
We hope you have enjoyed gospel time today. If we can be of any help, please let us know by writing to The Church of God at 4601 South Drexel Boulevard, Chicago, Illinois, 60653, or phone 773-548-7133. If you would like to visit with us, our order of service is as follows. Sunday morning Bible school at 9:15 a.m. Sunday morning worship service, 11 o'clock a.m. Sunday night worship service at 5 p.m. Tuesday night worship service at 7 p.m. Prayer service on Thursday at 12 noon. And Friday night Bible class at 7 p.m. Visit our website and like us on Facebook at churchofgodofchicago.com. Also, join us live on Periscope at COGOC Gospel Time. As we bring this message to a close, we would like to leave this scripture from the Word of God with you. Proverbs chapter 3, verse 7. Be not wise in thine own eyes. Fear the Lord and depart from evil. The musician for today has been our pianist, Sister Naomi Horton. Your reader and announcer for today has been Sister Alice Allen. May God bless and keep you.
Alice, you guys are audience at this time. Those who are in social media, those are in the audience now. We would like to beckon you with a call to God. At this time, as we present to you an altar call, to my left and to my right, there's a prayer room. And truly, I must say, even to those out in social media, what we're dealing with here is a message which was set forth because someone's struggling with the power of influence. Someone is struggling with a power of another individual or individuals in their lives which is affecting them with their call to God. There's a scripture in the Bible that says, but the fearful and the unbelieving. And the reason why I'm bringing this out is because as the elder Jason was preaching today, I know some of the topics he brought up, I know it struck fear in the hearts of people. Because now they're at a valley of decision when they have to make a decision now. Now God is saying, in this sense, I'm going to talk your language. The ball is in your court now. I've given you grace. I've given you an opportunity to break that cycle of that power of influence over you. God said, this is your day of deliverance. Not just being delivered, amen, from sin and of itself, but finally being delivered from that influence which has kept you from coming to God. And I'm going to tell you, one of the number one influences, we can put it on the devil, and yes, that's true, but it comes in the form of men and women.
Sure.
That relationship that you're in.
That's right.
That girlfriend you're holding on to, what is she going to think about? That man that you're trying to please out there in sin, and what is he going to think about? If I give myself to God, God is saying, put your life in my hands.
Yeah.
Now is your opportunity. And again, to my left and to my right, there's a prayer room. Someone here is in the valley of decision. As a choir gives us a song here, this is to aid you, to help you. Messages like this do not come just in vain. God said his word will not return unto him void. God is looking for fruit from this word. Because he sent his special delivery to meet your need. Someone here is under the bondage of the influence of men. You think you have a reputation, but in God's sight, that reputation is nothing. It's useless. God has given you this opportunity this day to be delivered. Is there one? Come today. If you're not saved from your sins, God is saying, come this day. On social media, those who need God, even now as we make this beckoning call to you, you can pray to God right now. The Bible says if we confess our sins, God is faithful and just to forgive us our sins and cleanse us from all unrighteousness. If you're willing to make that commitment, God will make a commitment to you. Not only will he deliver you, he'll keep you saved. He'll give you peace that you're longing for. Oh, my friend, do you see what you're missing? Why continue on in the same old rerun? Under that same influence, not being delivered by people, what people will think. We're not going to re-preach, but I want to see you, show you the power of influence and what it's leading to. Yeah. Hosea, the 7th chapter.
Yeah.
Hosea, 7th chapter, verse number 8. Some of you may need this. Hosea 7 and 8.
Ephraim. He had mixed himself among the people. Ephraim is a king.
That power of influence got them so that they entrenched, that they feel to be validated in life. They have to mix or integrate with people. They feel they get their acceptance from people. And God is trying to influence that you to stay, you have to be delivered from people.
Yes,
to get anywhere in life, to get away from the life of sin, many people are still bound in sin because they're mixing themselves with people. They want to be it out there. They want to be Miss Thang out there. They want to be the man out there. Because people are pumping them up. Thinking of giving them a reputation that there's something when God said you're nothing. Ephraim mixed himself amongst the people.
Ephraim is a cake, not turned.
A cake that's even half-baked is no good.
Amen.
You're useless with a life without God. That's how God sees it. We need to think about it now. If sin is so destroying my life because I want to follow people and God has made a way of escape for me, why should I stay in that state? God said your life is half-baked. People can't even enjoy your life because you're half-baked. It goes on to say strangers have devoured your strength. And the sad part about it, you don't even know it. So one more plea to you. See, this is a thing where you have to come to a realization. Let me tell you something. Let me give you a quick testimony. Before I got saved, over 30 years ago, I was deeply involved in a relationship with a young lady. And little did I know that that relationship turned into an idol. Meaning that when God was dealing with me long time to stop the sinning, the devil kept bringing and presenting this young lady to me. What are you going to do with her? And each time during that time, I would reject God and put her before God. She became more and more of an idol. She became more and more of an idol, something that I was looking to more than looking to God. But here's the key to that. By doing that, my life took a turn for the worse. The relationship was getting sour. Listen to me. This girl was religious. Now here's a turn in the story here. This girl was religious. As they say, a church girl all her life, but was not living right. The things we would engage in was not the life of a saint. So as God started dealing with me, when I finally got the nerve to say enough is enough, I'm tired of this influence and this idol in my life. I gave my life to God, but I had to break that bond. Let me tell you something. The closer I got to God, the more that girl disdained me. The more that girl disdained me. Now, she was religious, Brad. Listen, this girl was religious. I was an outright sinner. The more I got closer to God, and I finally gave my life to God, that girl disdained me. But I had to make a clean break. I had to make a decision. I had to break that power of influence. God put me at that crossroad. This day, choose life. I sit before you life and death. Which one are you going to choose? Keep on with this girl. You're going to choose death. Choose me. You'll have life. Over 30 years ago, God has kept me saved. No turning back. No looking back. No desire for that anymore. And And see, the devil don't want you to see the good things God has for you. By staying faithful to God and giving up that idol, that young lady was not for me at all. That life of sin, God turned that around shortly. I got established, got saved, but God blessed me with a beautiful, beautiful wife. We married almost 28 years. No looking back. It took that break of influence. That's why we're making a plea to you today. Because we know such is common in the things that we were in. Such is common to you as well. Someone out there is struggling with a relationship. Someone out there is struggling with something that they keep putting before God. And God is saying, give it to me. Come unto me, all ye that labor and are heavy laden. It hurts to see people laden down, weighed down because of sin, and they don't want to turn it loose. They don't want to give it to God because they think they can handle it themselves. You tried long enough. Now, this final plea to you, as the choir gives us one more selection here, come to God, to my left and to my right. Where are you at in social media? If you desire prayer, we're here to pray with you. Struggling right now, they just don't have that courage. They say, if someone just would pray for me, say, so let's pray, let's pray, let's bow our heads and pray. But if that's someone who's struggling, if you just raise your hand and acknowledge, I need help now. If you just need that help, no one's looking down on you, we're here to help you. If there's one, just raise your hand. Just one. If there's anyone out there struggling like that, they need God's help. Don't let pride hold you back. Is there one? We're not even calling you to the altar now. Just raise your hand. God will meet you where you're at. We just want you to make the effort to break this cycle over you, this cycle of bondage. Is there one? Is there one? Is there someone just to raise their hand? Have the courage. Have the courage to say, God, I need to break this cycle. God is here right now. Is there one? Even if you just raise your hand. Just God give them the strength to raise their hand just to say, God, help me. God, help me break this cycle. You see where I'm at. I'm struggling, God. I need strength right now. As we offer a word of prayer, that God will bless. Let's look to the Lord in prayer. Our Heavenly Father, in Jesus Christ's name, we know your word did not come in vain. And we know, dear God, that, Lord God, that Satan has people bound, dear Father. And Lord, we're praying that God, you give them the courage and the grace to break free, dear God, whatever struggle they may be facing, dear God. Lord, as the scripture says, come unto me, all ye that labor and heavy laden. And Lord, we pray that you will bless them even now, dear God. Father, as you talk to hearts, we know, dear God, is troubling someone. We know the water is troubled, dear God. Lord, we're praying, dear God, you break that, bless that soul to break free, dear God. Lord, as you talk to their hearts, even now where they are, Father, your word says that we confess our sins, you're faithful and just to forgive us our sins and cleanse us from all unrighteousness. If they make that commitment in their heart where they are now, dear God, Lord, we pray that you'll save them and deliver them, those who are struggling, dear God. Lord, whether it's relationships or influences over their lives, and Lord, they don't see a way out. Lord, let them know that you've opened the door for them, a way of escape. Bless them this hour, this moment, dear God.